My name is Andrew Koenig, president of City Furniture. City Furniture is a furniture retailer, been in business since 1971. I'm second generation. My father and my uncle started the business then together. My uncle actually was a bellman, raised $1,500 and opened up our first store. And now we're South Florida's number one furniture retailer.
Oh, that's exciting, Andrew. Thanks so much for finding time to be with us on the Ivy Podcast today. Tell us a little bit more about your role within the organization, what falls under your purview, and maybe a little bit more background on City Furniture.
Sure. So City Furniture's home furnishings retailer, online, in-store. We got about 34 locations in South and Central Florida. I'm the president, so you know all departments report to me. So we're processing, you know, customers from, you know, we like to explain it like very, you know, starting price point, strong value customers all the way to, you know, the lower high end. So our store strategy is 100-120,000 square foot stores, big product lineup. We want to be able to cater to whatever style price point that the customer wants and really capture the majority of that mass market that needs furniture for their lives.
That's exciting. And I'm personally very familiar with City Furniture, and we've purchased quite a few pieces from you guys. They're outstanding quality. So definitely that's exciting. So, you know, I always wanted to talk to somebody who is, you know, who's behind this, who is building this organization, who's building this culture. So that leads me to the next point that I want to talk about is building the culture of innovation. And I would imagine that for a furniture organization like City Furniture, continuous innovation is at the forefront for you guys to continue innovate, not only the product, but your internal processes, your methodologies, how you guys serve your clients and so forth. Just wanted to hear a little bit more around some of the strategies or initiatives in place that allow you, as you know, as the president of the organization, to really build and foster that culture of innovation.
Yeah, so I think it starts with our values. So our number one value of our company is entrepreneurial spirit. And I think that's, you know, very relates to constantly reinventing your business, and innovation, specifically technology, is absolutely necessary in order to be a really innovative company. So at City, we've talked about, you know, we're actually trying to become a technology company that sells furniture. And that's how strong we are at really, you know, really trying to understand, you know, where technology is evolving and what capabilities are out there. And, you know, we match that back with our furniture expertise, listening to the customers, listening to our associates. And we try to be as entrepreneurial and give all of our associates, whether they are inside our tech department, data, analytics, digital, IT, infrastructure, whatever, or part of our sales team or ops team, and just give suggestions. So we really are strong about including everybody in our strategic planning process. So, you know, a lot of that gets a lot of the innovation thinking, you know, going in our organization. And we're actually in that process right now, about to wrap up our and close out our annual plans for next year and our 5-year plans. But really, I think getting everybody involved and creating a culture where everybody feels like they can give you an idea. Literally 5 minutes ago, I got an email from someone in tech, you know, newer person on the team, just giving me 50 ideas of how to reinvent our business. And I love that. That makes me feel really good that everybody's out there thinking on how to get better, how to solve more problems faster. And I really think it starts there. And then, you know, then we have the formal systems in place, suggestion systems, strategic management systems for good communication, and, you know, feedback loops. And we carve out certain hours per week for all of our technology team to work on tech projects that are important to them. We're very serious about making sure all of our leaders in the organization have available time for problem solving. So again, I think all that combined really allows everybody to tap into their super amazing brain power and solve some serious problems and keep us ahead of the loop, you know, when it comes to our competitors.
That's exciting. And, you know, you've mentioned something that definitely resonates, that inclusive culture, you know, reaching out to all levels within the organization and soliciting feedback. You know, that's, you know, and we've seen a lot of successful case studies where organizations, you know, come up with really, really cool products and, you know, for their, you know, services where they, you know, where they listen to their staff. They listen to all levels within the organization because that's, you know, they're the front lines. They deal with these problems on a day-to-day basis. So that's super exciting. What also stood out when you were talking about building the culture of innovation is the use of technology. And I think these days, you know, if you're not considering yourself a technology company, you're probably, you know, a little bit behind the eight ball. And from advanced technology perspective, such as, you know, machine learning, AI, RPA, and so forth, they're reinventing a lot of industries as a whole in general. I'm curious to get your take on how will this impact your industry, how will this impact furniture industry in general, and what are your thoughts on implementing and, you know, leveraging these advanced technologies as part of your operations?
Yeah, so I think, you know, in a high level, we're all problem solvers. We're just trying to solve problems, get better. But in order to really do that, you need amazing data, accurate data. And so, you know, where my head spins is what we've been working really hard the last few years is really just trying to clean up our data, organize our data, have it accessible, democratize it, you know, share it, make it visible, transparent. And then, you know, you get your data infrastructure really organized and at the fingertips of the team, then, you know, then our teams can, you know, start applying, you know, machine learning, AI, which we are doing in several projects in our company. And it, what's that doing is just, you know, eliminating waste and making us more streamlined, helping us, you know, predict, you know, what's going to happen and providing automation where we can. And we're just getting a little bit more efficient and a little bit more accurate with our problem solving decisions because of that core data infrastructure and, you know, layering those cool technologies on top of. So, those that aren't, you know, really going down that journey, you know, I try to generalize it to our team a lot is they're just not going to solve as many problems as fast as we are. So, you know, we have to be doing these types of things if we're going to respond to the customer and solve the next new problem or prevent the next new problem. And the only way to do it is really start having good, organized, clean data and then applying those really cool, you know, better in class technologies like AI. And I think it's inevitable, you know, you got to be going down this road. I mean, that's why we're really trying to, you know, psych our people out. Like, we're not a furniture company, we're a tech company, and we just sell furniture. Right. And that forces us to be, okay, if we're going to be a tech company, then we compare ourselves to tech companies versus maybe a furniture retailer down the road. So we're feeling good on that. That mindset is really working.
That's super exciting. And for our audio listeners who are not seeing the video, there's a background behind Andrew with a wall full of metrics, full of graphs. It's like this really cool, board, I guess, with all of the different metrics. I see some progress tracker and, you know, some SLAs. Tell us a little bit more about the role of data and how do you leverage that to make some strategic decisions, and how does that help you guys with driving innovation?
Yeah, so what you're seeing behind me right now and what every department has in our organization is what we call our Enterprise Management Development System boards, our EMDS boards. And what that's is doing is just visualizing the main and sub goals of every department. And, you know, as my role as president, it summarized the story of what's currently going on of our main goals and our sub goals of our company. But if you go all the way down to if you go to every department and down multiple layers in our company, they have their own EMDS boards visualizing their main goals, our sub goals. I brag that we have the most efficient admins out there in the world because, you know, we're trying to get better safety, better quality, better customer satisfaction, better productivity, better teamwork, associate satisfaction. That's what we mean by that. And we're measuring the current state of everything and how we're doing towards achieving those goals. And, you know, if we're ever hitting those goals, we'll just raise the bar and we'll continue. We like being in the red is what we say, behind goal, because that forces the problem solving. So that forces you to dig into the data to figure out why am I not hitting that new main goal. And so that thinking, you know, at my level or down to our admin level or any department, our sales team, our ops team, our customer care team, our supply chain team, everybody has that same exact system in place. And again, I hate to be very generic, but we're all just problem solvers. We have goals and we just need to problem solve to get to those goals every single day. And visualizing that data is critical. So, you know, behind me is the physical board. Obviously we have a lot of digital data everywhere that's accessible, but we also believe in the very physical visual boards as well to kind of nicely remind you, you know, how you're doing and force it, gets your brain going every single day.
Right, absolutely. You know, I recently read a blog post or an article that talked a little bit around the strategy of when we talk about the physical boards, and that, as you know, all of us being remote these days, the dynamic completely shifted with how we collaborate, how we work together. And as you were talking about being, you know, a problem solver, I think having that physical reminder seems pretty simple. Yet, I believe that it's pretty powerful to have that as a constant reminder that these are our goals. And then also something that you've mentioned resonates very well with me in terms of actually looking forward, seeing something red on some of these dashboards, where it's not necessarily perceived as a problem, but more of an opportunity for us to improve, for us to actually fix something that maybe not working. So I love the whole mentality of, you know, oh my God, here's a problem, what do we do now? But instead having that approach, we will get these opportunities to improve on a daily basis. So let's treat it as such. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and you can see behind me, I got a lot of red behind me. And, you know, several years ago, about a decade ago, our bigger problem was getting people to feel comfortable bringing up problems. That's scarier when your organization, your associates, your leaders are afraid to bring up the problems to the boss. Well, then that means you got a lot of hidden problems everywhere. So if you know, myself and other leaders in the company can lead by example and say, hey, we're not hitting that goal either. You know, I'm not an idiot. You know, it's hard. It's probably a hard problem to solve, you know, and by the way, I'm making it visible. So, hey, help me. Give me your ideas. You know, let's work together to solve that problem. So, you know, I think it's really helped our teams feel more comfortable bringing up problems and not being afraid to say, I don't know how to hit this goal. Can I have some help?
No, absolutely. And that's, you know, goes hand in hand with building that culture of innovation. It's a mentality, it's the mindset, it's the whole, you know, how the organization operates. So that's super exciting. Speaking of trends and ideas to innovate, what ideas and trends that excite you the most from your industry standpoint? Which ones are you tracking and researching more than the other? Maybe perhaps you looking to make an investment or implement at your organization when it comes to, you know, latest trends in your industry.
Yeah, I think in retail, you know, one of the big holy grails out there is really, you know, whether the customer shops online, walks in store, goes back home and buys online, you know, how can we tailor that experience to wherever she is on that journey? And, you know, we're trying to have that unified customer ID is what we're calling it internally. So when they, you know, whether they bought a mattress last month and then they go on our website and they see a totally different experience, maybe it's showing pillows or sheets, or, you know, maybe it's providing information on how to sleep better at night, or we, you know what I mean? So I think, you know, depending on the big thing that we're really working on, goes back to what we talked about earlier, is getting that data really cleaned up for our customers, and then having the ability to have a very personalized customer experience wherever they are in their journey, post-purchase, pre-purchase, or it's been a year, they already bought a mattress. Why would we send them a mattress advertisement? You know what I mean? You know, how do we send them the next new purchase? They've had a sofa in their home for 8 years. Typical people change out their sofas every 8 years. So, you know, how do we really tailor that communication, you know, pre, during, post, personalized to that customer? So a lot of that goes back to that data discussion. So we're really heavily investing in our data analytics team, org structure, management system, tools, systems, process improvements, and then working, you know, with our department heads to understand that journey, and then, you know, tweak and solve, you know, again, solve one problem at a time and really try to make a very awesome customer experience. So that's where I'm spending a lot of our time. And that's where our team, I think, is really exciting, because we don't see too many people in retail doing that really well. and are really not many. And it's tough. So, you know, we'll see how we do. But I think that's like where if you're in retail, that's one of those really awesome problems that you want to solve that we're working on.
Right, right. Absolutely. No, I love that. You know, just being a little bit more proactive in a sense, what can we predict? What can we offer our clients and customers in terms of they may not necessarily know that themselves, but us using the data, us using the trends, us using the past historical purchase activity, stuff like that, to be able to come up with something that, you know, your customer may benefit from in the future. I think that's, you know, from trend perspective, I think that's super exciting. Want to shift gears a little bit from, you know, discussion around the innovation, technology, you know, use of data is around, you know, the topic that's, you know, I'm very excited about is around hiring, building high performing teams, and just in general, surrounding yourself with winners. Because at ProSource IT, that's what we specialize in. We specialize in, you know, in advanced technology staffing and IT services. And from your standpoint, when hiring for your teams, first things first, just want to get a glimpse into an interview with Andrew. So if your candidate comes in, I'm sure they've gone through already multiple rounds of interviews. When they get to you, tell us a little bit more about the interview experience. How does it look like? And more importantly, what do you look for in some of the responses when you hear them?
Yeah, I think, you know, number one, you know, right fit. Are we a fit for them? Are they a fit for us? Good culture alignments to our values, you know, so, you know, family spirit is a big, you know, value to our company, continuous improvement, mutual trust and respect, entrepreneurial spirit. So, you know, those values, we're going to try to find out if that person through questions, really, you know, align well to our values, you know, your values as a human being are tough to shake, right? Or create or, you know, develop over time. So I, you know, if we're trying to hire a role in the next month or two, you know, you really have to live our values, you know, giving back to the community. You know, we really have to make sure you fit our culture. You know, that's number one. You know, depending on the role, experience and, you know, past projects or, you know, all that, you know, technical skills, skill set, you name it, all that's important. But, I hate it. I didn't really think this conversation was going there, but I'm really looking for problem solvers. You know, I'm really looking for someone that loves to solve problem, whatever it may be, because we're just psychotic about, you know, making everyone an investigative journalist or private eye. You know, it's we want everybody to come with this mindset every day to figure out how to get better and solve problems for whoever it may be, internal, external. And then I think another one that we'll definitely try to poke at is do they develop themselves? Are they constantly trying to learn, get better? And you know, that's really important. So you got those elements, you know, that's pretty much what we're looking for.
Right, absolutely. No, that makes sense. And it goes hand in hand with everything that we were talking about, building that culture of innovation and, you know, finding the right people that will fit that personality-wise, skill-wise, you know, experience-wise. And that's very exciting to hear for you to be able to give them an opportunity to interview you as well to see if, you know, they are the right fit. And I recently interviewed the CEO of Deloitte. And one thing that he spoke a lot about is during the interview process is picking up of some flavors, you know, flavors of arrogance in the sense that if a candidate is more focused on their personal goals, personal achievements, personal ways of doing things rather than the team capacity and be able to collaborate and contribute to the group, I think that's a bit of a, you know, I guess something to watch out for. So I thought that was pretty cool from that conversation.
Yeah, teamwork's one of our values as well. We have seven, and I think I rattled all of them, but the last one's giving back. But yeah, that's a really important one. Good call.
Right, absolutely. What are some of the most in-demand skill sets that are hard to find in your industry? And what do you guys do about, you know, attracting that very niche, very specialized skill to your guys' organization?
So, you know, all the technological skills are being very difficult to find. Data analytics, data engineering, analytics, you know, great developers, security roles, you know, great project management. So, you know, digital marketing, you name it, e-commerce, developers, I can go on and on. But anything to do with technology has been really difficult for us. Obviously, we're a retailer, so we're actually one of the few furniture retailers that actually employ its own drivers. So that's actually a pretty challenging hire. But those would be like the two, you know, technology roles, drivers be the top ones. What are we doing? So I think from the technology side, I'm actually getting more involved into the technology talent. So I'm spending a lot more time with our current tech teams. Well, a lot more pre-COVID, doing, you know, catching up now. I'm getting more involved in community organizations, technology community organizations throughout South Florida, Central Florida. So that I'm trying to expand my own personal ecosystem, which I would recommend any company do. And a lot of these great organizations have done a lot of good. Just expanding your networks, you know, is a big deal. And then I'm asking our leadership teams and technologies to do the same exact thing for me. And we're carving out time so that they have the time to do that. This Friday, we have a tech golf tournament and I'm pulling everybody out of the office and we're all gonna go play golf and meet a whole bunch of new folks in the technology space and many different industries on this Friday. No intentions other than to just meet some new friends and see where that takes us. So those are the big ones, I would say. Just expand your networks, expand your organizational footprints, go to these meetups, you know, on whatever topics and try to go have a beer and meet someone that you've never met before. And what do you know, they have a connection because, you know, a year from now, you need this skill in your company and all of a sudden your friend that you met a year ago can, you know, knows a guy or knows a girl. So I really think that's what I'm doing more than ever. And we are obviously adding a little bit more budget to our recruiting strategies, our internal resources to partner with organizations and get more out there so we can funnel the pipeline versus I need it next week. Like, let's start working on next year's plan today. Right. So those are some ideas off the top of my head. And drivers is another challenge. I don't know if you want to bore you with, but a lot of hard work in there too.
Right. I can only imagine. And that's exciting to hear that you being as the leader of the organization, being very open and very vocal and, you know, available out there. You know, that's actually, you know, I agree with you. It's a contact sport. It's all relationship based. That's actually one of the reasons why I started this podcast, is to be able to, you know, to build meaningful relationships. And, you know, a lot of opportunities open up from there. And smart. I think, especially, you know, in IT specifically, where it's such a small community, to be able to, you know, and for you to come to, you know, forum like this and talk about your leadership style, your strategies, I think that also is a great testament to great leadership, to be able to put that word out there to potential candidates, partners, customers, and so forth. So I definitely appreciate that. Andrew, last but not least, what are you currently reading? And what is one book that you always recommend to others, and why is that?
Yeah, currently rereading The Phoenix Project.
Love that.
I love the book. We're about to give our you know, I think for the second time to all of our tech team. And I think we're in a good spot with our processes and systems and culture. But I know, you know, with more and more projects, trying to do more with, you know, less, which is all what the book's all about, you know, it's a really nice, good refresher to get your mind right on how to have a big year. So, The Phoenix Project is what I'm reading right now. And I definitely recommend it to anybody in the tech space that has not read it. You have to read it.
Mm-hmm. Right. No, absolutely. Couldn't agree more with you. And for our listeners, we'll make the links and title available in the episode notes. Andrew, thanks so much for finding time to lend your expertise and talk to us today on the Ivy Podcast. I definitely look forward to staying in touch with you, and perhaps we could do another episode in, 6 to 1 year, month, and see how much have transpired.
Anytime, John. Appreciate it, bud. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Andrew.